Hello everyone. This video will demonstrate how to do a Grignard reaction, a common reaction in your textbook. For this lab, we will use the Grignard reaction to produce one of two dyes with similar structure. Malachite green, which has a beautiful blue-green color, and crystal violet, which is a beautiful blue-violet color. To make these dyes, the Grignard reagent needed will be that from 4-bromo-NN-dimethylaniline, shown in red here. You can see how that piece shows up in the structures multiple times. The chemical process for a typical Grignard reaction sequence is three reactions done sequentially in the same flask. First is formation of the Grignard reagent. Then you add a carbonyl compound, usually, to react with it. Finally, add water and acid to get to your final product. In our synthesis, there will be four reactions, since we are going to form the Grignard reagent in two steps. Why? Because the reaction goes faster that way. First, we will make a Grignard from N-butyl bromide in the usual way, that is, adding magnesium to an alkyl halide in the presence of an ether, here THF or tetrahydrofuran. That makes a Grignard reagent, but not the one we wanted. But then we're going to do a magnesium halogen exchange. This is a reaction that's not in your textbook, but it's a cute trick to get the Grignard reagent we actually want, but faster. Overall, the reaction is faster because aryl bromides, like the 4-bromo-NN-dimethylaniline, react only slowly with magnesium, but alkyl bromides, like N-butyl bromide, react quickly. And the metal halogen transfer is fast. So win-win. Once we have the Grignard reagent we want, we then react it with the ester for your particular synthesis. Your product will end up with an OMGX functional group. Don't forget to balance this equation. In the final step of the reaction we are doing, the acid causes a reaction beyond the usual Grignard product. So the structure ends up as your dye structure, as opposed to the regular alcohol of a Grignard. The glassware we will use for this reaction is a 25 mil round bottom flask with small magnetic stir bar, the usual condenser, the glass stirring rod, the glass vial, and an item you may not have used before. It's a drying tube containing fresh blue dryerite. Dryerite is anhydrous calcium sulfate, a substance that can absorb water. It is blue when free of water, but due to a trace of cobalt chloride indicator, it turns pink when it has absorbed enough moisture to need replacement. So if the tube in your drawer looks like this, then you need to put the pink material into the bottle in the lab so designated and replace it with blue. The drying tube is filled by putting a piece of cotton in the neck, put the dryerite in, and then another piece of cotton. You don't have to pack it tightly. This may make you guess that a big difference between this experiment and others that you've done is that the glassware must be totally dry, not just dry enough to not see drops. Any water present, unfortunately, will cause the reaction to fail. So for this experiment, we will oven dry our reaction glassware. A day or two before the lab, you will place your clean air-dried glassware in a hot oven. Then your professor will remove it before lab and cool it in a desiccator. The desiccator has in it dryerite to keep the atmosphere dry. In the lab, you should remove a round bottom flask with magnetic stir bar and a condenser and immediately assemble and place your drying tube on top. Then take your assembly to your workstation. The drying tube will keep the air inside the apparatus dry as long as it is not open, because all the air that gets in must pass in through the dryer. For this experiment, we are using syringes to measure out the liquids. Sometimes they're a little hard to read. What you do is read at the end of the plunger. Now, some syringes, like this one, have a stopper on the plunger. That's the black thing that you see here. You will read the syringe at the circumference of the stopper closest to the needle. The dome is ignored. So if I were going to get it to 0.4, it would be right there. If I tilt it this way, you can count how many graduations down that part of the stopper that's touching the walls hits. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is the syringe we use to obtain 78 or 76 microliters of our desired ester. You can see that you are going to have to read between the lines. Can you see where 78 is on this? Now we'll use the syringe to obtain a sample. This syringe is a very small bore, and so you can expect a little time lag when you pull liquid up in it. It will delay behind your pull. Stick the needle under the liquid and pull and wait. You may see that there's an air bubble that happens, and after I stop pulling, it then is smaller. When you see how much you need, you're going to go above that number, so I'll go up to about 100, and I still have an air bubble. With the needle straight up, you may have to tap to get the air bubble up to the top. Once you do that, put a little Kim wipe over the end and eject until you get to the amount that you want. The excess will be coming out in the Kim wipe. Make sure you have your syringe pointed away from you. The specially dried anhydrous THF, that's tetrahydrofuran, is in a sealed bottle under a dry atmosphere, so the cap should not be removed, but the needle of the syringe can go through the cap's septa. You want to have at least the volume of air as you are going to take liquid. I'm going to go for 1 mil. So I insert the air to equalize the pressure because we're pulling out a milliliter of volume. We start by pushing it through the septum, and it may take a little energy. Push the plunger in. Pull the liquid out. You may see that there's an air bubble in there now. We will get rid of the air bubble. So now we tilt it upward, and you can see the bubble has gone to the top. We will then take a Kim wipe, put it near the end, and eject the liquid and the air bubble, going down as far as our desired volume. wipe the needle. Now, what I do once I have the liquid in my syringe is deliver it into the oven-dried capped vial that was dried for you before the beginning of the lab. Your instructor may, however, prefer that you take the liquid-filled syringe to your workstation and add the liquid directly to your reaction mixture. The magnesium we use has been freshly sanded to expose a more reactive surface, so do not touch it with your bare fingers or you'll contaminate it or get moisture on it. To fit the magnesium into the bottom of the flask under the liquid that will be used, it's a good idea to curl the magnesium you have weighed into a loose ball or two, like this, more or less. I am going to be doing malachite green in this demonstration, since green is my favorite color. The procedure for both dyes is the same, but the amounts of reagents and the identity of one reactant, the ester, are different. So since you will be making only one of these dyes, it would be a good idea to highlight your amounts in the directions before you start to avoid confusion. We will be setting up the reaction in the fume hood, and we'll need to move quickly after opening the apparatus assembly to keep it dry. So I thought I would first go through the steps more slowly. Here are my weighed solids with the magnesium curled up and the glass vial with the N-butyl bromide and THF from the syringes. Once we take the flask off the assembly, we need to add all the reagents quickly. It is important to not get any solid or liquid on the joint of the flask. So I will use a funnel made out of paper if an appropriate plastic funnel is not available, so that I can keep it off the solids off the joint. Magnesium, that's easy. My paper funnel I make out of a piece of paper like that, cut like that, and then roll it, stick it in the flask, check that I've got it down underneath the joint, then add my solid. Get a tiny bit outside the flask. So my weight is a tiny bit off, but at this point we really have an excess, so even if you spill a little bit, you're all right. Okay, now the liquid. And we have it. After the compounds are added, you need to grease the joint connecting the flask to the condenser. So basically what you're going to do is just take the grease, take a little bit with a stick. You want to do it thin, but pretty much just one stripe down each side. And then you take the flask, put the condenser on it, and twist. You should see that now, instead of having the joint be opaque, it is quite clear.